iko hapo. Na pia nimeuliza KBC kama wanaweza fanya screens mashindani. Watafuta mahali kama Eldoret huko kwa square, Kisumu pale kwa square Kenyatta Stadium, watu wa keti waone rally vile inaendelea live stage, kila kitu through inchi yetu, station yetu ya KBC. Tunamuomba kabisa na mweke amani kwa mabarabara, hii overlapping tuachane nayo, kila mtu atafika mahali anaenda. Asante sana. Jina langu ni Maina Muturi kutoka Kenya Motorsports Federation Chairman.
Well, it is the 20th of March 2024, and you're just in time for KBC's lunchtime news on this fateful day. And of course, we're keeping a close eye on the doctor's strike that has entered its seventh day today, with medical services being paralyzed across the country. And of course, what is the way forward? We have the latest for you in regards to that. Welcome once more. My name is Abdiaziz Hashim. My co-anchor is Lensa Odingo. Now, I do understand my co-anchor is Lucy Mora. Sorry for that particular mix-up. Let's start with that particular story of the doctor's strike entering its seventh day. I do understand that the unions are currently meeting at the Kenyatta Hospital to diverse ways in terms of talking about the doctor's strike. Let's get to listen in on what is happening there.
But we realize that despite our goodwill, the government was digging deep and deep. We saw yesterday when the Ministry of Health reduced the salary of interns by 91%. And this morning, they were filing the same in court. Yet we know this was done on the back door. This was done in contravening the CBA of 2017-2021. So in the morning, we managed to close the services and the emergency services that are being done at Kenyatta National Hospital. And we are here with all the doctors at KUTTRH to also close the services. We are here and we made a resolution that even the bare minimum services, the emergencies that were being offered at KUTTRH are now closed. And that is the reality. And this will continue until the KUTTRH stops the casualization of doctors, yes, where doctors are being employed on locums, where doctors are being employed on one-month contracts, yes, where doctors are being employed on three-month contracts, yes, and some are being given 7 years contracts. Yes. So there is no career progressions. There is no hope to get pensions to be dignified as doctors when they're offering the services. And therefore, this strike in KUTTRH, the strike in KNH, the strike in MTRH, and the nationwide doctor strikes will all be called off when we have collective bargaining agreements that protect the value of workers and the dignity of the doctors in the places of service. Yes. So as of today, all the services in KUTTRH, all the services that are being offered by doctors across the country are in a halt. Yes. And we are saying we are joining the government. So it's upon the government to make the decision to offer services to the Kenyans. They have been on a strike for a very long time. Today we are joining them. Yes. The KUTTRH Board of Management have been on strike for quite a while. We are joining them. Yes. The KNH management have been on strike for a while. We are joining them. Yes. Because we saw at KNH where doctors were being paid a third of salary with their colleagues. They're contravening the ILO Convention C-100.
Well, those are live images. You've just heard from the KMPDU Secretary General, that is Davji Atellah, that the strike will still go on today, entering its seventh day. Our reporter, Joseph Wakhungu, is on that particular bit, and he will duly inform us in our subsequent bulletins. You also do remember that the unions, other unions within the health confines, also threatened to join the doctor's strike. And of course, we're keeping an eye on those developments. Now, I want to take you live to Kisumu, where we do understand the government is seeking to introduce standardized counseling manuals and a digital platform for the age information as it seeks to address the triple threat of sexual gender-based violence, teenage pregnancy, and early marriages. As you can see on your screen, our reporter, that is Simon Ochola, is joining us. Simon, good afternoon and good to see you. What more can you tell us about this?
Well, good afternoon, and thank you very much, Hashim. Of course, the issue of HIV in the country has seen different complexities coming in when it comes to the fight against HIV. And of course, the latest discourse we are actually having is about the triple threat, and that is what is actually being discussed here in Kisumu under what is being said is the Lake Region Economic Block discourse on a triple threat. And of course, we will straight into it, then we actually get to understand what is actually being discussed. And we have Dr. Serim here. Daktari, the issue of the fight against HIV in the country has always revolved around access to information. And of course, this time again, what is actually coming out prominently is how then we can actually pass relevant information to key population in this particular fight against HIV/AIDS.
Yes, thank you very much. Of course, one of the strategies of fighting HIV and making sure that we prevent our adolescents and young people from HIV transmission is information. And I think from the national government, we are doing that one. We have enough strategies to make sure that the youths get information. We have understanding adolescents and making sure that in collaboration with the Minister of Education and other stakeholders to get this information of prevention, of making sure that the adolescents understand themselves, they know they have their life-saving skills, and they understand the prevention of HIV in there.
Mm. And we're going further, not just in terms of providing information, but also having a guideline to parents so then they can actually counsel the adolescents at the very basic level of their homes, but also ensuring that the platforms through which they actually get information, the digital platforms, they actually have relevant information.
Yes, we are at the final stages, and we actually now currently have a parent guardian guide where this gives information to the parents to make sure that they are in a position to counsel their children, adolescents, and the young ones. Also, at the same time, the Minister of Health is coming up with a standardized digital platform to make sure that we give information to the relevant age and the relevant information to the relevant age. So that is actually what we are now doing. And we also want to bring the issue of making sure that we have strategies to have social behavioral change. We know in the society.
And of course, we'll link up with our reporter once more, Simon Ochola, in our subsequent bulletins as he prepares that package for you in terms of the triple threat, including gender-based violence. Let's continue with our news here in the studio. Residents of Isiolo and its environs have been urged to exercise caution when handling animals and their products following the discovery of Rift Valley fever in animal samples. This as the government, along with the partners, has initiated a mass vaccination campaign dubbed One Health to curb the spread of zoonotic diseases among the Rift Valley fever.
Addressing journalists, County Deputy Governor James Lowassa flagged off a comprehensive response team to tackle the spread of the mosquito spread disease.
Tunashukuru sana national government kwa sababu wametupatia vaccine. Na hii vaccine ni ya kudunga na wanyama ndio hiyo ugonjwa isiweze kuenea.
While there are no confirmed cases of human transmission in Isiolo, neighboring counties of Marsabit and Wajir have reported cases, prompting urgent measures to prevent further spread.
County jirani ya Marsabit na Wajir, Rift Valley fever imepatikana kuwa positive pia kwa binadamu na pia iko positive kwa wanyama.
Ile jukumu kubwa kabisa ni kuleta mashirika pamoja ndio tuweze kwenda pale mashinani kuhamasisha wananchi wetu jinsi ya kuweza kujisuia na ugonjwa wa Rift Valley fever.
VSF Swiss Kenya Area Program Manager Douglas Machuchu asked for extreme caution among herders while assisting with animal birth and disposal of carcasses from steel or aborted animal births.
Ona mnyama ameafya mimba. Usienda kushika hizo. Usienda kushika hizo bila kuvaa vitu kama gloves. Kwa sababu hizo viini zinaenea wakati unakuja in contact na hiyo aborters.
Joan Junge for Lunchtime News.
And now to a developing story where the government is considering to revisit the initial decree to retest the drivers operating public service vehicles in the country in a bid to curb a road carnage that has seen over 20 people dead in a span of a week. Now speaking before the Senate Transport Cabinet Secretary, that is Kipchumba Murkomen, stated that the ministry has foregone the decision last year following a hue and cry by the drivers citing oppression.
Mr. Speaker, the statistics show that most of the accidents are as a result of drivers' behavior. Mr. Speaker, when I announced last year that the drivers will be retested and that you will not get a certificate, the driving license retested, there was hue and cry. And many people say that we were oppressing drivers. But everybody goes through retesting. Lawyers go through every year through training. Doctors do the same. Mr. Speaker, drivers who are carrying human life should be retested so that we know those who are competent. We test even up to their alcohol content and drug abuse possibilities among the drivers. These are things that we should support as people of Kenya.
And in other news, the Directorate of Public Prosecution is once again on the spot over the delay in prosecuting 29 individuals implicated in the 7.8 billion shillings COVID-19 scandal. Now, the Ethics and Anti-Corruption Commission CEO Twalib Mbarak revealed that in the last 3 years, the DPP had thrice returned the commission file with recommendation to cover additional areas. The National Assembly's Public Investment Committee, now in that particular report to the Committee of Implementation, has summoned the DPP Renson Mulele over the matter. The ghosts of the COVID-19 scandal continue to linger 4 years later. One of the recommendations in the 196-page report by the Public Investment Committee on the Special Audit on Utilization of COVID-19 Funds was that companies that exorbitantly sold face masks and surgical masks to the Kenya Medical Supplies Authority, KEMSA, between March and July 2020, return the excess amount. It is for this reason that the Rafael Wanjala-led Committee on Implementation summoned relevant bodies to track the report's implementation to curb a recurrence of the scam. The gravity of the matter saw an unsatisfactory answer by the Medical Services Principal Secretary Harry Kimtai, who was fined 500,000 Kenya shillings but then relieved by a pardon.
Now this information has come to me and I'm asking for leniency.
The committee has resolved that he does not pay the fine. It's not going to be there anymore.
EACC CEO Twalib Mbarak revealed that in June 2020, the commission received allegations of irregular procurement and a payment of COVID-19 emergency commodities at KEMSA to the tune of 7.8 billion shillings. As at 15th of August 2020, KEMSA had paid 4.9 billion shillings to 61 entities, with 2.9 billion yet to be paid. Talib, however, revealed that the reports on the probe have been returned thrice by the Director of Public Prosecutions, DPP, hence the delay in bringing the culprits to book.
As from September 2020 up to 2024, that is almost 4 years down the line, there has been no prosecution on the KEMSA suspects. ESCC has done its work. They have recommended for the prosecution of those particular officers. But up to now, the matter is in the office of the DPP.
Out of the 7.8 billion, almost 2.8 billion was money meant for the universal health coverage, money that is supposed to have been spent for health issues in the counties, money that was not available to KEMSA as part of its capital budget.
The committee has therefore demanded that the DPP Renson Mulele appear before it in 2 weeks' time. And in other news, environmentalists are decrying the increasing amounts of garbage washed into the Lake Naivasha stakeholders, which they warn in threatening the lake's ecosystem. With the contamination of Lake Nakuru, the Nakuru County government has embarked on rehabilitating the riparian land and establishing drainage systems in estates to rectify the situation.
With increasing concerns of poisonous effluents from surrounding settlements affecting the purity of water and quality of fish, stakeholders around the lake are seeking urgent intervention.
Whatever we have here, if we don't clean it today, we'll head straight to the lake. It will affect the fish, of which it does affect the fish. So we are in a situation whereby we can say that the fishes of Lake Naivasha one day might be like those of Lake Nakuru, because this is where all this drain is headed in there.
In line with the efforts by the Nakuru County government to control the situation by establishing drainage systems in the estates, the area MCA Alex Mbogua, who led a cleanup exercise in Kihoto Estate, said clogged drainage systems were worsening the situation and increasing waterborne diseases.
If we don't really plan on how these waters will be managed in future, I think we shall be having diarrhea here. We shall be having cholera here, typhoid here, bilharzia here, because the kids within this estate, play within this estate, they don't have major fields here. So this is a category of a drain that we must work on.
Area residents concerned over the pollution thanked the county government for the cleanup efforts, hopeful that it will help contain the increasing diseases and restore the lake. Raf Wangutusi, Lunchtime News.
The Kipsigis Council of Elders and Religious Leaders are mourning the death of Joshua Chumo, who died aged 123 years. Now, Chumo was the founder of the Kipsigis Council of Elders and Peace and Mercy Church of Africa. Now, speaking in Kericho County, the Kipsigis Council of Elders Chairman Richard Ngeno eulogized him as a visionary leader and a strong peace ambassador who contributed to advocating for peace during the 2007-2008 post-election violence.
Alikuwa mwasilishi ya New Kipsigis Council of Elders. And New Council of Elders lisachiliwa mwaka wa 2000. Alishukulikia mambo ya amani na mambo ya kanisa mpaka wakati alipoaga. Ingawa miaka yake alikuwa miaka 125, akupoteza ufahamu. Alikuwa na hekima na maarifa yote.
Elsewhere, Old Mutual Health has introduced a self-collection HPV DNA kit aimed at boosting cervical cancer screening rates in Kenya. Now, speaking during the partnership announcement ceremony, Ken Omami, the general manager of Old Mutual Health, expressed enthusiasm about the potential impact of the initiative on the public health. Omami noted the self-collection kit will enable women to conveniently collect samples on their own, eliminating barriers to testing and empowering them to prioritize their health.
The collaboration between Old Mutual and Seba Lancet And we as the gynecologists have also come on board for this very, very important collaboration. As I said, that
elsewhere, a multi-agency security team led by NACADA and the National Police Service has identified Isiolo and Wajir counties as major marijuana transit routes. Northeastern Regional Commissioner John Otieno says security apparatus will set up roadblocks at various strategic points to deter entry of marijuana in the country from Ethiopia as the government steps up its war against drugs and substance abuse in the country.
Areas that are affected by this trade, and I'm happy to report that Wajir County have been able, through the multi-agency teams, to put necessary roadblocks to counter those who are trading in. We have identified some officers, law enforcement officers, in Garissa County, who are owning bars. And I want to tell them they either resign today or we catch up with them.
The National Assembly Departmental Committee on Health has appealed to the national government to allocate more funds to the Kenyatta University Teaching, Research and Referral Hospital for the completion of construction work within the facility. Now, speaking during a fact-finding tour at the facility, the committee chairperson, Robert Pokose, said a total of 19 billion shillings was required for the completion of the Modern Cancer Center and Children's Wing.
You will get the money, the 100 million for the children's hospital. Please start it. We'll make sure that in the next budget, I think we put money. We'll be able to put money into it. And we want to build it in phases so that we can do one phase. We do like that, until we are able to finish it. So we'll put money in the children's. We'll put money in the LINAC. We'll see if we can also squeeze something to get for the next generation sequencing.
Next generation sequencing machine. This is the machine that is able to establish the genetic makeup of the cancer, so that when you are treated, you are being given medicine for the right cancer. We are not able to do that in Kenya. We normally send the sample to South Africa.
And in other news, various government agencies have initiated programs to ensure inclusivity in accessing public services for those with hearing impairment. Among them are teaching sign language to civil servants handling members of the public who need government services. Now, speaking during the training of John Mora from the Kenya Institute of Special Education, KISE decried the many challenges facing those with hearing impairment. Now, the program will be done on rotational basis in various parts of the country.
We have a center where we are training government workers and other employees of the government on Kenya Sign Language. This is where we want to impact knowledge to people who give service to the community and the citizens, the ability to help people who are deaf, people with hearing impairment.
Kwa vile sasa nimeshafanya sign language, wakikuja ninajua nitasaidia wengi. Unlike previous wakikuwa wanakuja and then unatafuta karatasi, ukiwapea wanaandika, alafu ndio unaona unawasaidia namna gani. But I'm now happy that at least nimejua the basic one so that nikirudi kule nitasaidia wengi.
Residents and public institutions in Maragua, Murang'a County are set to benefit from water connection after the completion of the construction of the Maragua Dam in 2023, which costed the taxpayers 1 billion shillings. Now, the dam, with a capacity to produce 860,000 cubic meters of water daily, is expected to reduce the challenge of water shortage in the sub-county. Now, Murang'a Water Sanitation Company will be responsible for the distribution of the water across the county. More than 1,000 homesteads have been connected to the water grid in the last month. Now they target to have more than 20,000 homes connected with clean water by June this year.
Tangu museme muwasko ichukue maji, sisi tumetosheka. Na wacha hiyo kabuni hiyo inaitwa muwasko iendelee na kutupea maji. Saa hii tumeona tofauti kubwa sana. Kuna kabuni zilikuwa zinakuja hapo bereni. Sisi tulikuwa tunakaa wiki mbili bila maji. Hii muwasko inatupea maji kila siku, maji mingi, maji mingi.
Tulikuwa tunakosa maji wiki mbili, wiki tatu, mpaka tunaenda kusota maji gedhaja. Na gedhaja imechanganya na nini, na siweji. Sasa najikuna, ukifua guo, ukifua hiyo nguo najikuna. Lakini siku hizi, tuko haa gagara kabisa.
And given now in the second week of Ramadan, at least 500 needy households in Maluani village in Kaloleni sub-county, Kilifi County, are set to benefit from food donation program courtesy of Direct Aid International Foundation. The organization's branch manager, Abdurrahman Sheikh Ahmed, said the food assortment is aimed to sustain beneficiaries in tough economic times during the holy month of Ramadan. He further said the organization will continue with the feeding program throughout the holy month.
Watu walikuja kupokea chakula hii kwa mlasa wa Ramadhan, na hii ada tunafanya kila mwaka ifika Ramadhan. Tunagawanya watu ambao wajiwezi chakula ya kufutari, na tunashukuru pia serikali. Tuko na sisi hapo DC pamoja na chief.
And 21 minutes past the hour, we take our first commercial break on KBC's Lunchtime News. Don't go too far. We still have an interview for you in the business segment in regards to the hotel industry. After the COVID-19, have they started to pick up, and what is the business like within, among, or among the hoteliers? Don't go too far for that particular interview.
Watch the Mozartbet Cup as teams from both the top tier and low tier battle for the ultimate prize of representing the country in Africa's CAF Confederations Cup. Catch all the action live and exclusive on KBC Channel 1, beginning with a round of 16 matches, the quarterfinal, semi-final, and the final. Mozartbet Cup, live and exclusive on KBC Channel 1, your true sports partner.
This is a very exciting moment, not just for Naivasha, not just for the county of Nakuru, but also for Kenya.
Thing is crazy. I mean, the sheer speed, you can hardly see the road. These guys are really professional. It's really something out of this world.
Ask me whether I want to do this again.
I'm not sure.
Welcome back, and thank you for staying with us. Now, residents of Kalama sub-county in Machakos County have petitioned the government to hasten the process of subdividing the region into three divisions in a move they say will bring the government services closer to them. They claim majority of them lack important documents like the national identity card, birth certificates, due to absence of administrative divisions in the area.
The government has been urged to move with speed to address the plight of residents of Kalama sub-county in Machakos County, who for lack of an administrative office in the vast constituency, travel as far as 20 kilometers to acquire important documents.
Hata ukitoka mahali tuko, kwenda kwa maofisi ya division, ukitoka kitu saa mbili ya asubuhi, unafika huko saa tano. Tunalipa kama shilingi 200 kuenda na kurudi. Kwa hivyo serikali mtusaidie mtubadilishia hii sub-county yetu location, tutafurahi sana.
Elsewhere, Form 4 student at Orero Boys High School in Rangwe sub-county in Homa Bay County has committed suicide by hanging himself inside a toilet. The county police commandant Samson Olekina said the body of the deceased student was discovered hanging from the toilet's rooftop a day after his father visited the school to discuss his academic performance with teachers. In Mombasa, Governor Abdul Swamad Nasir has urged members of the county assembly to support ODM deputy party leader Hassan Joho's bid to succeed Raila Odinga as the ODM party boss.
Naomba Mwenyezi Mungu ajalie mabega yenu yasiwe yenye kuregarega tukaanguka, kwa sababu nyinyi mkiregarega tumeanguka sisi. Siache kuamini uwezo wa viongozi wenu pale ambapo kwamba tunapoelekea ni njia hii. Chama si cha pwani peke yake, chama ni cha Kenya nzima, lakini sisi tukimpa nguvu kule nao watamheshimu. Na serikali ya William Ruto kupambana naye haitaki mtu goigoi. Haitaki mtu mwoga.
Finally, mother tongue and Sheng language influences have been cited as major cause for the dismal performance in languages amongst learners in secondary schools. During a Swahili subject competition in Machakos County, learners couldn't answer Swahili trivia and compose initials most will apply their mother tongue and street language.
Lakini kila ambacho tumefanya ili kukabiliana na changamoto hiyo ni kuhakikisha kwamba wanafanya mazoezi ya mara kwa mara.
Kiswahili kimedunishwa sana miaka mingi, na sisi kama walimu wa Kiswahili tukaonelea ni vyema jinsi ambavyo tunasema ya kwamba Kiswahili kitukuzwe. Nasi tutakitukuza.
Nimeweza kutambua changamoto moja ambayo imewaadhiri wanafunzi wote ambao walishiriki katika hiyo karatasi, na nimeona ni swala la makosa ya sarufi.
Ningependa kuhimiza wanafunzi wenzangu wazidi kutia maanani, wazidi kusikiza walimu wao.
Timothy Kipnoso for...
And now welcome to the world of business. The Kenya Space Agency has signed a deal with Konza Technopolis to use a data center for its operation. Under the deal, Kenya Space Agency will access Konza-based infrastructure such as a data center, secured cloud and data. Now, Protection Facility, Kenya Space Agency Acting Director General Brigadier Hilary Kip Koske says the agency is keen on deriving data in areas such as agriculture, disaster management, security, communication, urban planning and resource management. Now, if you are a smallholder farmer, you can now adopt innovative financing models to purchase otherwise expensive farm inputs such as tractors. Haifa International Senior Vice President for Africa, Aduse Fedi, says smallholder farmers using innovating financing models such as paying for equipment as they use it is attracting the youth into farming and increasing incomes without the worry of saving now and buying later.
The main impact of this report and how it will benefit smallholder farmers is the fact that smallholder farmers already know that they would love to have mechanization. Well, mechanization was not affordable nor was it accessible to them. I think that the interesting thing about this project is the ability to have the tractors available in the communities where the farmers are, so that the farmers are guaranteed that when they actually ask for the tractor services, they would actually receive the tractor services. I think the overall impacts are things that our farmers already know. The farmers understand how much time they are spending and how much money they are also spending to invest in labor to get them ready for agriculture. The farmers also know that the time it takes them to prepare their land before the rain starts is not enough for them to actually cover all of the land that they own. Most of the time, they can only cultivate half of their plots before the rain starts, and sometimes even less. With tractorization, what could have taken them weeks to complete, the farmers get completed in days, and they can actually cultivate more land and therefore grow more food. The other most important thing is that farmers will begin to learn from this experience is that as they use a mechanization that allows them to be able to have more efficient planting, the yield for every hectare will increase by fivefold. I think that agriculture is a sector that every government in the continent is willing to support. Mechanization or agriculture or youth integration into agriculture for that matter is a desire that the continent has continent-wide. A number of years ago, all the agricultural ministers across Africa met to agree that the youth agenda, integrating it into agriculture, will be a major focus for the continent. That tells you that this is already an agenda. What is now missing are the right strategic partnerships for government to work hand in hand with to be able to execute. I think that it's not about adoption rates, it's about availability. We have the lowest tractor penetration, and on a scale of 1 to 10, we are on the minus when it comes to what we're thinking about the scale. If our average is 15 and that for the rest of the world is 200, then it is not an adoption rate that is the challenge. It's an availability rate. It's a service ecosystem readiness that we're talking about. Our last mile does not have the supporting infrastructure to make it economically viable for tractor owners to provide services to smallholder farmers, period. And if we don't fix the problem as a whole, not just as a part, we cannot address it. Business must drive the incentive for continuity of any solution we create for smallholder farmers. I always say that it's not that the poor are looking for charity. They are looking for services that are designed to meet their needs at a price point that they can afford to pay. And once we can make this all work out, then we have a thriving and a sustainable ecosystem. So the challenge is not, are farmers willing to adopt mechanization? The issue is that mechanization is not economically viable for service providers. But through this business model, we have had a chance to take a closer, laser-focused look at the different aspects of the challenges that have stopped farmers from accessing service they need and service providers providing services from which they can also earn income. And I think that that's what this model is doing, and we hope that that's the story that we can tell from the report that we have put together.
As promised, now we want to delve in into that interview we promised on the status of the hotel industry, especially following the COVID-19. Despite happening 4 years ago, the impact it had on the hotel industry was massive, and want to get to know if they've been able to keep up and what are the trends within the sector. Joining us this afternoon to take us through this particular course will be Michael Kimani, the GM, Riata and Nabo Residence. Michael, good afternoon and welcome to the show.
Thank you, Abdi, for having me.
So, Michael, and let's start on that note, where I want to know the current status of the hotel industry. How is the feel right now, especially following that COVID-19 wave?
Yeah, thank you very much. Mm-hmm. Let me start by introducing Riata Apartments Hotel. Mm-hmm. We are located in the serene part of Melimani, a walking distance to CBD, mm-hmm. on Rough Bunch Road. That's where we are located. We have 62 units. Those are apartment hotels. And we've been in operation for more than 12 years. But now to your question, mm-hmm. hotel industry is really growing very fast. Okay. Apart from the derailment and the setbacks we got from with the COVID-19, 2021-22, mm-hmm. it started growing up in 2023. And as we speak today, Like for us, we operate at 80%. That shows this growth. One, it's been attributed by political stability.
Okay.
Two, the good environment we have now, business environment. Mm-hmm. As you know, Nairobi's a regional hub.
Yes.
But another negative maybe thing we didn't consider as stakeholders, we don't have enough hotel beds. Mm-hmm. So you find when we have big conferences, we tend to spill over now to Airbnbs. And that's where Airbnbs came into place, because hotels could not satisfy that market. And Airbnbs came up without standards. Mm-hmm. That's why you could hear of these cases concerning the Airbnbs. But the hotel industry, it's growing. And the future, I think I'm seeing a very positive future.
Mm-hmm. Yeah. And of course, given that you've seen Kenya, we have been hosting many, many summits, and many more have been announced. So if you say you don't have beds, how are you going to accommodate those guests?
Now, investors, I'm calling investors. Mm-hmm. There's opportunity in the hotel sector. Mm-hmm. We need to invest more hotels. Mm-hmm. We need to have more hotel beds, so that when we have big conferences, we can host them comfortably.
Mm-hmm. Yeah. And given that now you have raised the issue of the Airbnb now, let's say, for example, given that it is catchy, we have seen people going with it. So how is the hotel industry, such as yourself, leaders such as yourself, coping with this new trend?
Yes, solution for that is to create a product to suit that market. The Airbnb market is a bit low, so we need to come up with a product which suits that market segment. Mm-hmm. In the hotel ranking, it's the lowest. Mm-hmm. So for us, we've come up with so many products. One is giving rates, lower rates, for those people who want to, let's say you want only room, you can get a bed-only rate. If you want bed and breakfast, you want hourly. Like in China, they do hourly rates. Mm-hmm. Somebody is in transit and you just want to take like 4 or 5 hours nap, so you need a place which can give you that. Mm-hmm. So I think we've not tapped into that market and create more opportunities and with better standards, because the, most Airbnbs don't have standards. It's just somebody opening up a house and letting people come in. Mm-hmm. We need standards and we need regulations. That's why hotels now need to come in and create products for that market.
Mm-hmm. And of course, we have seen you guys, especially within the hotel industry, taking advantage on foreign tourists. So when they don't come, have you over-relied on those foreign tourists and negated the domestic tourists within the country?
Yes, that I can say it's true. Mm-hmm. And I think going forward, we need to broaden up. Mm-hmm. We have so many attractions in Kenya. And within those attractions, we don't have either hotels or resorts. So we need to, investors need to come in and help create those resorts. And then now we create awareness. Once you have the facilities within the attractions, now we create awareness. That way we'll tap into the local market. Because we only have the normal Mara, you know, the coast region. Mm-hmm. We've not tapped into other attractions within Kenya, because there are a lot of sceneries within our country which we've not really utilized, and tap into the local market.
Mm-hmm. And have you also considered, given that I know most of the issues that Kenyans normally raise is the rates that you provide, so do you consider that in mind, especially with the current economic status?
Yes, we have. What the hospitality industry does is come up with different rates. These foreigners, the local rates. So we need to create awareness also to our local tourists that we have special rates for them.
Mm-hmm. And indeed, tell us, what are the trends maybe that has been cropping up despite the Airbnb within the hotel industry, and how are you coping to acclimatize to those situations?
The trends, the future of hotel is technology. Mm-hmm. So you find now the current challenge is upgrading the equipments, the amenities we have to match the growing technology. Mm-hmm. Like in the conferencing, we need state-of-the-art conferencing rooms which can do live presentations, because now the world is global and we need to embrace that is one area which now we in hospitality industry need to invest in that. and also amenities we need to modernize. Like in service, it's easier to, once we modernize, it makes it more efficient and reduces also costs.
Mm-hmm. And of course, we know all about the sustainable tourism within the sector itself. So how are hoteliers such as yourself promoting sustainability within the tourism sector?
We've started going green. Mm-hmm. One is to reduce emissions. Mm-hmm. Like for us, we've reduced use of diesel generators. We've gone solar. We've gone for our laundry, we use steam. And also plastics. We use recyclable plastics. Mm-hmm. So we've avoided a one-time plastic because those ones really create environmental challenges mm-hmm. because of disposing. So for us, we've the plastic bottles. Now we are using glass. In the rooms, we use soap dispensers. Unlike the ones which they're wrapping. Mm-hmm. So we've gone green.
Mm-hmm. Indeed. And of course, green is the way that most even the government is promoting for. And with that in mind, has the government come forth to help the hoteliers within the industry, especially the Ministry of Tourism?
Yeah, I can say in general the government, because there's a program. Mm-hmm. If you invest in green energy, you get credits mm-hmm. and get financing. Like, if you want to install solar in your facility,
yes,
there are companies which have been assigned to do that, and they can finance. You agree with them, this is how we'll finance. Part of it is paid by the government, then part of it now is the establishment, which uh-huh. you can pay within a certain period, depending with the agreement you have. Uh-huh. But they've really helped.
Mm-hmm. Yep. And what is the outlook, especially for 2024? I know it's too early to call it. We're just in March. For those 3 months, how has the hotel industry been, given that last year you said you're operating at 80%?
Yeah, this year is very good, very mm-hmm. good, very good, because we have bookings until August. Mm-hmm. Yeah, it's I can say it's very, very promising. Mm-hmm. Yeah. Mm-hmm.
And then finally, tell us, with your predictions of the future, how will the hotel industry look like, and what are some of these emerging challenges that you keep acclimatizing to and solving to when you get there?
The future for hotel industry is conferencing. Mm-hmm. Everything, most business, most opportunities are in conferencing. Mm-hmm. And I urge now investors, we need to work into expanding mm-hmm. our conferencing facilities. Challenges is the cost, because it comes with a cost. Mm-hmm. Yeah.
Mm-hmm. And tell us some of the recommendations you might have or policies that you have come up with that you like to propose before the government so that they can make the hotel industry have a conducive environment to operate in.
If we can get subsidies, mm-hmm. And also maybe create some fund whereby if we have some pandemic, mm-hmm. like hospitality can be affected by terrorism. We need to have a fund whereby if such a thing happens, there's a fund to cushion hotels. Mm-hmm. Also, because we pay staff. If we don't have money, we can't pay them. So if we have such a fund which can cushion the hospitality during calamities, it can go a long way.
Mm-hmm. Yes. Maybe give us your final remarks, given that we have come to the end of this conversation.
Thank you very much, Abdi. Mm-hmm. And I want to welcome you to Riata. Mm-hmm. It's a pleasant place to relax and stay. And we are known to offer the best hospitality in Nairobi. So come and experience and be a testimony to stylish living. Mm-hmm.
Thank you so much. That is Michael Kimani, the General Manager of Riata and Nabo Residences, just giving us an update on what is happening within the sector of the hotel industry. You do know that it was affected badly by the COVID-19 pandemic. 3 years later, from experiences, Michael is telling us 2023 has been good, but in 2024, they even hope it will be better. That will, of course, conclude our conversation, and we'll also keep an eye on the industry itself. Let's continue with our stories where the Kenya Power is banking on a multi-agency team to tackle transformer vandalism and illegal power connections. Kenya Power Coast Regional Manager, that is Finesse Marete, says vandalism of transformers and illegal electricity connection cost the utility firm about 2 billion shillings annually.
We have quite a number of cases involving people, calling customers, telling them that they will be disconnected if they don't pay them some money. Others are being told that, oh, we will give you a huge quotation if you don't pay us this amount of money. All those are criminal activities. Our security teams are moving around the region to ensure that once those particular new connections are identified, we have to either ask the customers to pay for them if they are found to be standard, and if not standard, then we demolish.
Also, the Agriculture Development Corporation has rolled out a training program for artificial insemination services providers and farmers on breeding in efforts to boost, enhance the quality of livestock products. Under the training, farmers are being taught on the best practices in dairy and beef livestock management as well as bookkeeping.
57 counties so far with agents distributing the genetic materials that are required by the farmers at a very subsidized price of 200.
To achieve that objective, we have a state-of-the-art bull station located in Kitale that is producing close to 600,000 doses of semen.
Also, content creators who develop a digital educational material will henceforth assign revenue sharing to monetize their content. This is after Longhorn Publishers partnered with Safaricom for the rollout of a digital learning platform targeting learners, teachers and partners, offering them diverse educational content from multiple publishers and content developers.
We are starting with an activity there.
Learners and tutors will access educational content with ease following the rollout of a digital learning platform with a repository of educational resources from multiple publishers. The teacher's dashboard features a centralized platform for lesson planning, content curation and assessment management, streamlining teaching workflows.
Content creators, financiers, and policy opinion shapers. As a business, we believe that the power of digital approaches with agility, we can also bring this to fruition by forging strategic partnerships.
Through the platform, educational content creators will be able to monetize their content through the platform.
So the first thing is affordability. Say it's for 2,000 shillings the entire year, you would be able to get more than 1,000 pieces of content. Right now, 2,000 shillings cannot give you that number of textbooks.
Videos, audio, educational games, quizzes and assignments are also on the platform.
Collaborative features for group projects and peer-to-peer learning has impacted social interactions and teamwork amongst the learners.
Frederick Mwoki for Lunchtime News.
Sales at Gucci are expected to fall by 20% in the first quarter due to the slowdown in Asia, according to its Paris-based owner Kering. Gucci is estimated to get more than a third of its sales from China, whose economy has been struggling. The luxury market has grown in the past decade, but sales have not been as impressive in recent years. Here are the details of this and other stories in our business roundup.
Profit warning reflects a steeper sales drop in Gucci, notably in the Asia-Pacific region. The firm is scheduled to report its financial results on the 23rd of April. Gucci accounted for two-thirds of group operating income last year. Kering's other brands include Yves Saint Laurent, Balenciaga and Bottega Veneta. Last month, Kering reported that its net profit last year fell by 17%. Its shares have fallen by more than 23% over the past year. In comparison, its bigger rival LVMH, which owns Louis Vuitton, Moët & Chandon and Hennessy, posted higher than expected sales for 2023. Meanwhile, Samsung Electronics expects $100 million or more of revenue from its next batch of advanced chip packaging products this year. Samsung's market in DRAM chips used in tech devices reached 45.5% in the fourth quarter last year, according to the data provider TrendForce. To do this, Samsung seeks to secure a competitive advantage in high-end memory chips required by booming artificial intelligence demand, including mass-producing a 12-stack version of high-bandwidth memory chips called HBM3E. For a future generation of HBM chips called HBM4, likely to be released in 2025 with more customized designs, Samsung will take advantage of having memory chips chip contract.
And now finally, let's play. The national women's volleyball team, Malkia Strikers, will face Gambia on Thursday in the quarterfinals of the ongoing 13th African Games in Accra, Ghana. Malkia Strikers defeated Algeria by 3 straight sets in their last Group B match to advance to the last 8.
Malkia Strikers labored hard to bag the first and the second sets, 25-14 and 25-19 respectively. The Japheth Munala Chargers came back stronger in the third set, which they easily won 25-7, to book a slot in the quarterfinals as a Group B winners. Malkia Strikers will face Gambia on Thursday in the quarterfinals. Meanwhile, the Kenya Ports Authority men's volleyball team has intensified training ahead of the 2023-2024 Africa Volleyball Cup Championship, scheduled for 14th to 23rd April in Egypt.
Expect to play better than last time, eh? In the last meeting, we were ranked number 6 in Africa. We were the number 6 club in Africa. But this time round, we want to make our training more intense so that we can get a better position, maybe a podium finish.
KPA will use the upcoming Kenya Pipeline Volleyball Tournament, slated for 5th to 7th April at Kasarani Gymnasium, to prepare for the continental assignment. The team is currently in a residential camp in Mombasa. King Orimwanki for Lunchtime News.
And now some good news. Team Kenya bagged 4 medals in athletics in the ongoing African Games in Accra, Ghana. Kenya won silver courtesy of Winnie Beale in women's triple jump, while Vivian Chebet and Evans Kiptum bagged bronze medals in the women's 800 meters finals and the men's 10,000 final, respectively. Now, the mixed relay team also bagged a bronze for Team Kenya after finishing third in the final behind winners Nigeria and Botswana.
Vivian Chebet settled for bronze in the women's 800 meters finals after clocking 2 minutes 27 seconds. Ethiopia's Tige Duguma won gold, while Ugandan Nakaya Lima grabbed silver. Another Kenyan, Lilian Odira, finished fourth. Evans Kiptum completed the podium dash in the men's 10,000 final, bragging bronze for Team Kenya. Another Kenyan, Peter Mwaniki, finished a distant ninth.
Position is Bogale, who is going to take the gold, followed by his teammate Dariba Gebetu, and Evans Kiptum comes across to claim the bronze medal.
The Kenyan mixed relay team finished third to win bronze behind Nigeria and Botswana, who won gold and silver respectively. Reigning world 800 meters champion Mary Mora qualified for the women's 400 meters finals after clocking 51.55 seconds in the semifinals, while Jacqueline Nanjala failed to meet the qualification time. National 100 meters hurdles record holder Rukia Omulisia booked a place in the women's 100 meter hurdles final, while David Nasayek and Kennedy Kimeu failed to qualify for the men's 400 meters final. National high jump record holder Zedi Jasire finished fifth in the women's high jump final. For Lantim News, I'm Sela Onyango.
Well, it is 53 minutes past the hour. That marks the end of our bulletin this lovely afternoon of the 20th of March, 2024. My name is Abdiaziz Hashim. My co-anchor is Lucy Maura. Do join us in our subsequent bulletins at 7 p.m. and 9 p.m. For now, good afternoon and enjoy the rest of your viewing.
kuna pale kwa atakaoniokolea yake.
Na nini?
12,000.
Hiyo pesa mkitoa mnafanyia nini?
Get rich quick. Kwani kuna doza bwanako na zako?
Fate will never leave Christine for you. You can take that to the bank.
Our bond is almost unbreakable.
Kwa nini ulimnunulia ile nguo? Is that what got you worked up?
Haya, mpatie.
Well, I'm sure that originally belonged to Jen.
Sasa kama amepata mtu mwingine, si ni aseme tu, laini iwe fupi.
I have losses to count.
Kamo wakubwa wangu na mjambo wadogo wangu. Nikitumai nyote mbuheri wa afya tangu wiki iliyopita tulipokuwa pamoja. Ni wiki nyingine tunakutana kwenye kipindi tunachokienzi cha mkulima. Tukiwa tayari kujifunza mbinu mbalimbali zinazotumiwa na wakulima mbalimbali na jinsi ya kufanya kilimo biashara. Kama desturi mie ni wako Frederick Mbadha. Karibu. Kwa kusikia neno mitishamba huenda ukadhani kwamba tunazungumzia uganga au mazingaombwe hii leo. La hasha. Leo tuko katika kitengo cha makavazi ya miti na dawa halisi hapa JQuat. Kazi kuu wao hufanya ni kufanya utafiti wa matumizi mbalimbali ya miti na pia kuhifadhi kwa ajili ya kizazi kijacho. Ebu tazama.
Miti shamba si uganga wala uchawi, ni miti tofauti tofauti ambayo hutumiwa kwa ajili ya dawa ili kuponya ugonjwa fulani, maua kama pambo ama matunda. Hapa ni kitengo cha botani hapa chuo kikuu cha JQuat, nao kazi yao ni kukuza na kuhifadhi miti ya aina zote.
Hii project tuko nayo hapa ni ya conservation ya plant genetic resources. Na hii project tulianza mwaka wa 2001. Tulianza ikiwa ndogo, lakini sasa imekuwa karibu 3 acres pale tumepanda hizo miti za conservation. Na hizo miti tunatumia kwa aina mbalimbali. Kuna zile za madawa, kuna zile ornamental species, kuna zile zinatoa chakula kama hivyo.
Makavazi haya yanasaidia sana kuhifadhi na kuratibu miti haswa ile ambayo inaenda kutokomea ama ile iliyosahauliwa kwa sasa.
Sasa hizo tunaenda tunachukua, tunakuja tunafanya utafiti, tunafanya hata tissue culture, na after zikiwa zimekuwa kubwa tunaanza sasa kutoa products from those plants. Na hizo products tunazi package, tuna test, tunaona zile active ingredients ziko ndani, and then we commercialize them. Na tuko na a sell point here hapa Jomo Kenyatta, pale tunauza hizo products.
Kazi hiyo nayo haiwi rahisi. Wakati mwingine inawabidi kusafiri hadi mwituni, milimani ama kwa mbuga za wanyama ili kupata mti fulani. Kwa mfano, mti chuma ni mmoja kati ya miti ambayo ulikuwepo hapo kitambo na ulikuwa unadidimia duniani. Na mti huu baada ya kufanyiwa utafiti na kukuzwa tena unapatikana milima Kenya na chuo cha JQuat 2.
Mti chuma ndio kwa botanical name inaitwa Ixora Kshefreri, subspecies Kshefreri. Hiyo mti ukisoma kwa literature utaona wale researchers walikuwa hapo Beleni walikuwa wamesema hiyo mti ilikuwa extinct in 1968. Na hiyo mti is endemic to Kenya, meaning that huwezi kuipata pahali popote kwingine duniani. Alafu in the year 2001, tukiwa Mount Kenya, tukifanya research zetu, tulikutana na miti kama tatu karibu na mto huko. Na ndipo tuliitambua, tukaona ni hiyo mti walikuwa wamesema ati imekuwa extinct in 1968. Kutoka hapo sasa tukaanza kufanya utafiti kwa hiyo mti, na nika decide ndio nitafanya utafiti.
Matumizi ya miti halisi huwa mengi. Kwa mfano, mwarobaini ama mkilifi ni mwafaka kwa kutibu homa. Pia kuna huu unaitwa mbugia yugadesis ambao pia una matumizi mengi. Kwa mfano, hutibu magonjwa ya meno, na pia ikichanganywa na miti mingine inatibu magonjwa ya tumbo, homa na kifua. Lakini dhana ya kwamba mti mmoja unaweza tibu magonjwa karibu yote si ukweli.
Kuna hiyo shida, na hiyo shida inayokuja sana sana juu kuna wale tunawaita quacks, wale wanaenda na vibuyu wakiwa na hizo dawa wamechanganya, wanaenda wakiuza kwa mitaa. Watu kama hao ndio wanafanya watu waone hii herbal drugs or hizi miti dawa kama ni sio kitu mzuri. Mimi ningehimiza watu wasinunue hizi dawa kwa kila mtu yule anaenda akitembea kwa barabara. Ni mzuri kununua hizi herbal drugs from established centers.
Basi, utafiti umebaini wazi. Hakuna mti mmoja uwezao kutibu kila kitu kama ilivyokuwepo hapo awali na mti ule wa Loliondo. Licha ya kwamba mti huo ulikuwa na vipengele fulani vya kutibu magonjwa fulani. Licha ya hayo, manufaa ya miti dawa ni mengi.
There is a lot of profits anaweza pata kutoka kwa miche, na most of the herbal products zile utatoa kwa miche hazina side effect kama zile unapata kwa synthetic or modern drugs. So nige encourage wao wajaribu kutumia product zile zimetoka kwa miche. Juu apart from them getting some money, wanaweza pia kuzitumia kwa nyumbani.
Iwapo ungependa kuanza kilimo biashara cha miti dawa, soko ni zuri kabisa, kwani watu wengi siku hizi wamegundua na kuzingatia matibabu kwa kutumia miti dawa, kwani haina madhara.
Ya soko iko mzuri sana. Watu wanatoka mbali sana wanakuja kununua hapa Jomo Kenyatta, na hata wakati wa the Central Kenya Show, the Nairobi Trade Fair, hata huko tunaenda tunauzia huko pia. Lakini hapa Jomo Kenyatta pia tumefungua a sale point ya the herbal products. Zile herbal products zimefanyiwa utafiti na tunajua kwa ukweli zinatibu zile magonjwa tunasema zinatibu. Na nimesema hizi magonjwa ni za watu, za mimea na za wanyama pia.
Changamoto ni nyingi. Miche hizi zote zilizopo mahali hapa na sehemu zingine zimetoka maeneo mbalimbali huku Kenya. Wakati mwingine kwenda maeneo mti uko ni kibarua si haba.
Unajua hizi miche zote umeona huku zote tumezitoa mbalimbali mbalimbali hapa Kenya. Sasa sometimes kwenda pahali ziko ni ngumu. Saa zingine unaambiwa mti iko kwa mlima juu, ni lazima sasa tujaribu vile tunaweza kufika huko. Zingine ziko in very far places kama northeastern, na sometimes insecurity in some places. Zingine tumepata kutoka kule Mount Elgon, huko ni Bali. So changamoto ya distance na hata places hizi miti ziko is normally the main problem.
Kwa sasa, lengo lao hapa kitengo cha miti dawa na makavazi ni kupanda miti aina yote kwa wingi zaidi ili kutimiza lile lengo la kuwa na miti nchini Kenya 10%.
Na vile mimi ningetimiza watu wote ni tujaribu, tupande miti kwa mashamba zetu, kwa barabara, kwa any open space that we have, towards trying to meet the 10%. Na kitu ile ingine ningeza sema ni hata tukipanda hizi miti, zina zile benefits zinatupea, sio kupanda for the sake of it. Sasa tumesema unaweza pata hizo dawa, unaweza pata shade kama hapa tuko, naona kuna shade mzuri sana. Hizi miti also zinakuwa nyumba ama habitat za wanyama wengine kama ndege, kama monkeys, kama vitu kama hizo. Kwa hivyo mimi ni kutimiza tu watu tuendelee kupanda miti.
Mwangi Nderitu ni mmoja wa wahandisi, naye alitueleza jinsi wao hutengeza dawa kutoka kwa miti.
Sasa tunaendeka kwa hiyo mmea umeshaamua ati hii mmea ndio nataka kuleta hapa. Unaenda kwa field, unaishuna kama ni matawi, kama ni stem ama mizizi. Alafu unakuja nazo hapa, unazikausha chini ya kivuli.
Baada ya kuona majani ama mizizi yako unayonuia kutengeza dawa halisi imekauka vizuri inavyostahili, basi kazi ya kusaga huanza.
Sasa tukishakausha, tukishaona imekauka vizuri, ndio tunakuja tunaiweka kwa mashini yetu hapa. Tukishaiweka hiyo na kisha hii mashini tunasiaga, hiyo ndio tunakuja nayo kwa rabu maambara. Alafu tunafanya utafiti tuone iko na nini. Alafu tukichajua iko na nini na tumeona kile tulikuwa tunatafuta iko, ndio tunakuja tuna package tunaweka kwa mikebe hii yetu. Hiyo dawa sasa inaweza tumika sasa.
Mti huu nao kwa lugha ya kisayansi huitwa papilionesea, na hufukuza wadudu na mbu nyumbani.
Juhudi kali huhitajika ili kutembea mbali mwituni, milimani na hata mashambani ili kupata miti hiyo. Wakati mwingine mti fulani huwa nadra sana kupatikana, hivyo huhitaji watafiti kuchemsha bongo ili kujua la kufanya. Si miti dawa tu, mbali pia mimea mingine hutumika kama mboga kama vile mulberry. Basi mie nikipata kopo la maji usibanduke, kwani nitarejea na mengi zaidi kuhusu dawa halisi na miti dawa. Karibu tena mpenzi mtazamaji wa KBC Channel 1. Na shukran kuendelea kutizama kipindi unachokienzi cha mkulima. Kipindi kinachokujuza jinsi ya kufanya kilimo biashara. Kuna kitengo fulani cha ukuzi wa miti aina mbalimbali hapa Sajorek Jakewatt. Nao ufanya utafiti na kukuza miti ya dawa, chakula, ujenzi na kadhalika. Karibu.
Kwa mbali ukiangalia mahali.